We're in the book of Ecclesiastes tonight. If you haven't turned already, we're in chapter 8 as we go through the Bible here on Sunday night. Solomon is writing a book of Ecclesiastes really from the perspective of a jaded old man. You know, he's a grumpy old guy at this point in his life, to say the least. You know, we were talking earlier how you could live your life with such great potential. But if you don't act upon the potential, you miss out. And Solomon certainly did that. And, you know, because he got his eyes off the Lord and he started chasing women. And he had more women than you can imagine. And they brought in their influence. And, of course, we know as you went through Chronicles and you took the Kings, we saw all the pagan temples there in Jerusalem that he had built, the high places and the various cultures in those days, and really had turned his heart away from the Lord. In the beginning of chapter 8, he speaks about his observation of people and his feeling of how they ought to respond and react around the king in verse 1 and 2. Who is the wise man? And who hath knoweth the interpretation of a thing? A man's wisdom maketh his face shine, and the boldness, or was the strength of his face, shall be changed. I counsel thee to keep the king's commandment that he regardeth of an oath of God. Keeping king's commandment and to regard the oath of God. He had said earlier, in as we were studying, that you should be careful when you speak, when you come into the presence of God, not to be too ready to speak or make a vow. You know, we read, it's better, he said, not to make a vow at all than to make a vow and to break it. When you come into the presence of the Lord, really to make our yeas be yeas and our nays be nays nay. You know why? Because you can't fake God out, can you? He knows everything about you, and so, you know, sometimes you think the only time you can come to the Lord is when you're doing well. Well, let me tell you, he knows when you're doing bad also, and that's the time to go to the Lord and talk to him about everything. He says in verse 3, be not hasty to go out of his sight. Stand not in the evil thing, for there doeth whatsoever pleases him. When the word of a king is there is power. And who may say unto him, what doest thou? He's saying God is king. The king, of course, were sovereign during that day. They had sovereign rule. They didn't have to answer to a senate or congressman or even a Supreme Court as far as that's concerned, what their word was. And really, as we look at it, isn't God one, you know, he's king. He's king over our lives, and one day Jesus Christ will rule. He'll be King of Kings and Lord of Lords, but he's going to rule in righteousness. He's going to do things the right way, and there's going to be this glorious form of government when Jesus reigns. I can't wait for that when the Lord takes over, when the Lord does what he would have us to do. In verse 5, whosoever keepeth the commandments shall feel no evil things, and the wise man's heart deceiveth both time and judgment. The timing again, we've dealt with that before the last couple of weeks. A wise man will consider the timing and good judgment. They'll take time to think about it. Because every purpose, verse 6, every purpose that there is a time and judgment, therefore the misery of man is great upon him. It's hard for us many times to wait for the perfect timing, isn't it? You ever been there? We are so anxious. We want to see things get down and done in my timing, when I want things done. But God has his perfect timing. Of course, I've shared this before, and I could tell you a great illustration waited upon God's perfect timing. Being 20 years old, all my friends were getting married. And I was, by the time I hit 22, I figured, I'm an old person now. Now I'll never get married. 24, 25, 26, 27. And then finally I met my gal. And I figured out, what in the world was the Lord having me wait all those time? There was a perfect timing, right? When I look back at it, because when I was 20 years old, she was 13. And I found out that's against the law in our country, right? And so there's a perfect timing for everything in our lives, the things that we do. You know, for he knoweth that not that which he which shall be in verse 7, for who could tell him when it shall be? It's timing again. I don't know when it's going to be. You ever try to figure out what tomorrow is going to bring? How it's going to be? Well, a lot of stock brokers try to tell you that they know, but they really don't. He says now he looks at really life and death. There's no man that has power over the spirit to retain the spirit. The Bible teaches that a man is basically spirit. He's living in this body. He's living in this tabernacle, and the body is designated and is tended for God for us to function within his body. But when we're done with this body, we go on, and you can't hold on to it. He says, neither hath he power in the day of his death. When death comes knocking on the door, we yield to it. You know, and he says, and there's no discharge in the war. There's a war that's going on, and there's no discharge, what he says, in the service, that one day we will all face death unless the rapture happens. And I can't wait for that. Neither shall wickedness, in verse 8, deliver those that are given to it. All this I've seen and applied to my heart unto every work that is done under the sun. There's a time wherein one man ruleth over another to his own hurt. I watched and I've seen people given authority. And I've seen the way they use their authority for themselves. You ever been in a workplace when somebody rises up with the power and how quickly they'll abuse that power for their own purposes, for their own gain? They might be a good worker. I remember being a plant manager one time a period of my life, and I would see these guys be tremendous workers. Tremendous work ethics, and then I would happen to promote them to be a supervisor. Let's say a graveyard shift or a swing shift or something. It's like, who is this person? I don't recognize this person, and they would become almost like animals. There's this personality that came out, and this is what he's saying: is that you got to watch out for these guys. In verse 10, he says, "And so I saw the wicked buried, who had come and gone from this." The place of the holy, and they were forgotten in the city where they had so done. This is also vanity, it's emptiness. Because sentence against an evil work is not executed speedily. Therefore, the hearts of the sons of man is fully set in them to do evil. Could you guys help them open up the door? Yeah, great. Come, to do evil. Though a sinner do evil 100 times and his days be prolonged, yet surely I know that it shall be well with them that fear God, which fear before him. But it shall not be well with the wicked, neither shall he prolong his days, which are as shadow, because he feareth not before God. You know, what we're seeing here, of course, often life seems unfair. You ever been there? And it says, where many good people suffer, many good people struggle, you know, and you see the wicked prosper. You know, and this is what we see. Notice verse 11. And we're in Proverbs chapter 8. Notice in verse 11, he says, because the sentence against the evil worked is not executed speedily, that leads the wicked to fatal mistake. What does the wicked think? Because they don't see things being executed speedily. What do they think? That God doesn't know. They some way or another, when they don't see their, you know, God really execute judgment upon them, they think that they're pretty clever. They're hiding their guilt, and they use these really fancy alibis with God, or they don't even talk to God after a while. And they figure they covered their tracks that God doesn't see. And well, let me tell you, he that created the eye, can he not see? You know, can I not see? Do you remember the story of David and Bathsheba? Of course, we all know it. You know, he thought he had a really good night, and he was able to have a great night with Bathsheba. He got everything taken care of, and you know what? She got pregnant. I'm taking care of that. Well, what about her husband? I'll take care of him. And we know the story that he, you know, he was able to have his husband taken out of the picture, and he was killed, and he thought everything was okay. Because why? This idea that God doesn't see. Well, the Lord raised up this other fellow. What was his name? Nathan the prophet. Then finally came and confronted David. He's, in essence, he was saying, God saw you. God saw exactly what was going on. He said, God sees you thoroughly. You know, he thinks that God doesn't care. This is the mistake, as we see here, that Saul is making. They mistake the long-suffering of God as approval. God's too remote. They don't notice. They don't know what's, he doesn't care what's going on. You know, it's important, you know, it's really, they think that God's impersonal. He doesn't know you. But I think it's very interesting where he knows the number of the hairs on your head. Well, he doesn't take much to count mine, you know. But he knows me thoroughly. He knows you, and he knows what's going on. You know what? Let me tell you something, good news. And yet he loves you. And he loves you. That's the good, the glorious news that he has for us. They think that God won't judge. And that's a big problem with the world around us. That there is, and you know, what did Paul said there in Galatians? Whatsoever a man soweth, so shall he reap. If you sow to the flesh, of the flesh you'll reap corruption. If you sow to the Spirit, of the Spirit you'll reap everlasting life. He says God will ultimately, you know, really do this work within our hearts. It also tells us in verse 11, their hearts are fully set to do evil. Men give themselves over to a life of sin. It becomes a way of life to them. You know, it's the fear of God in their heart is gone. You know, it's tragic to think that men plot to do evil. But isn't that what our flesh does? It's selfish. It just thinks what's in it for me. And when you leave God out of the picture, all you want to do is live for yourself. And really what he say as he goes on, and I love verse 12, in the middle part of verse 12, he says, I know it shall be well with them that fear God. Notice the difference? He says it's going to be good with you guys that fear God. Do you guys fear God tonight? Do you guys love Jesus? Let me tell you, all the way back there, it's going to be good with you because, you know, really what the goodness is that we have a future. You know, the total economical collapse we might see around us, devastated earthquakes that we've seen, you know, in the last short period of history, and people breaking down, you know, within our society. I thank God when our future seems to be uncertain, I'm glad we have the certainty for our future, don't you? Because it's going to be good with us. That's what Saul here tells us. And it says in verse 12, it shall be well with them that fear God. The fear of God is a wise choice. What is the fear of the Lord? We get the, well, it tells us in the Bible, the fear of the Lord is to depart from evil. You know what it means to depart from evil? You see evil from in front of you, you take your foot and say, foot, move this way. You know, it actually means to depart, to make a conscious decision, to remove yourself from evil, because I fear God and I know the consequences if I go down that road, it's going to end up in destruction for me. It's not going to be good. Verse 14 of chapter 8. There is a vanity or emptiness which is done upon the earth, that there be just men unto whom it happened according to the work of the wicked. Again, there will be wicked men to whom it happened according to the work of righteousness. And I said that this is also vanity. What he's saying is that there's are just men who suffer and there are wicked men who prosper. It's a difficult thing for us to understand, isn't it? Because if you were God, we could really mess it up. I sometimes I'm amazed. Part of what I'm really amazed is the patience of God, the long suffering of God, that he's not willing that any should perish. That's what Peter tells us, the reason why we continue, I believe, in living on planet Earth right now the way it is because God's great love for us, and God wants to still see people come to know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. And I would encourage you that you get actively involved in reaching your family, to reaching your neighbors with the gospel of Jesus Christ, and say, well, Pastor Terry, I'm not an evangelist. I go, yes, you are, because you could pray. Maybe people who have been mean to you, people who have been, you know, really showing their carnal nature around you, these are the ones that need Jesus. And if you're able to pray, to see him maybe one day sitting in here at this church or another church to come to know Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. That's why I believe the patience that we're seeing right now, why Jesus Christ has not come back for his church right now. Giving men and women opportunities to repent. The beauty. He tells us, then I commanded mirth, or verse 15, fun, because a man had no better thing underneath the sun than to eat and drink and to be merry. For that shall abide with him of his labors the days of his life, which God giveth underneath the sun. Of course, this is, again, a false conclusion Solomon is given because of his really carnal nature at this time. He says there really isn't anything life that you could experience other than what you could feel, touch, or drink, or whatever it is. He says, party up. You know, just go grab whatever thing you can get. But, you know, we, of course, know it's wrong. Because it always leaves the emptiness. You know, the life apart from Christ in any way will always leave you to be empty. Only when you surrender to Jesus Christ. Paul picks it up in the New Testament. I love the way Paul, you know, obviously knows this writing. He says, be not drunk with wine. He says, but be filled with the Spirit. Why would you live for a false substitute when you can have the real thing in the presence of Jesus Christ? That you can live in the Spirit and know the abundance of the Spirit day in and day out. One of the things that I've been doing the last few years, especially since COVID has started, is walking. And I find that I can go to a park and just go for a walk. You know, I love doing. And I talking to Ray earlier, you guys won't let me do it at the church. I love singing. And I found out the sparrows don't mind. and because it bubbles up. And that's what Paul was saying. Be filled with the Spirit. Allow the Spirit of God to fill your heart, to overflowing. In verse 16. He says, when I applied my heart to know wisdom and to see the business that is done upon the earth, for also there's that neither night and day sleepeth with his eyes type of thing going on here. Then I beheld all the work of God, that a man cannot find out the work that is done underneath the sun, because though a man labors to seek it out, yet he shall not find it. Yea, farther, though a wise man think he knoweth, yet he shall not be able to find it. You know, really, in a sense, he's saying it's true. What he's saying is true. We talked about this morning about all the philosophers of the day when Jesus was here. They set on such a quest to try to discover what truth was. You know, truth is a simple word in the Greek, or aletheia, and they tried every type of, you know, thought that they could have, and they got to a place, as we were talking earlier, where it was like it was during the time of Judges, and we adopted it for our own society. Men were doing what was right in their own eyes. Truth became whatever you wanted it to be that you could hang on to. But we find what Jesus said. He really destroyed them in that, because he came and declared what truth is, didn't he? He says, I am what? The way, the truth and the life. He says, no man can come to the Father but by me. If you want to find out what real truth is all about, then get to know the person of Jesus Christ. Learn of him. And I love it where God's ways, of course, to the natural man, he cannot find. God said, my ways are not your ways. My ways are beyond your finding out. The only way you could do that, the Bible says, is to know God's way. Jesus said, you have to become as a child. And you have to come to that place of faith, a trust in the Lord. And then you could discover God's way, the walk of faith. In verse 1, we read, for all this I considered in my heart, even to declare all this, that the righteous and the wise and the works are in the hand of God. No man knoweth either love or hatred by all that is before them. You know, in nature, you can't get a clear revelation of God because you look at fallen nature. You look at really fallen nature. Never what we see outdoors. I thought, Misa and I were thinking that maybe we'll take a trip this year because it's actually our 40th year, you know, being married. And we think, like, maybe we'll go out someplace and look at the stars, look at some mountain, do something, you know. But you, even in your most beautiful view where you can go up to Glacier National Park and the water's aqua and it's gorgeous up there. But it pales in comparison to what God originally intended and what he's going to restore and bring to us. In nature, you can come to an understanding truly that God exists as you look at the vastness of the universe and how large it is. But to try to get a clear understanding from God, from nature, it's difficult. You look, you know, let me give you an example. You look at a beautiful gazelle, right? We've all seen our National Geographic TV show, and you've seen them, and they're beautiful little animals. But then as you see them out running, and some silly lion takes them down. And it's really hard for us to understand and put this together, like how could a loving God allow this to happen? But then when you go and you look at the end of the book, in the book of Revelation, and you see the restoration of all things, the way God's going to do it, we see in that day the lion will lay down with the lamb and the little child should lead them. Can you picture that? Could you picture that a child will have a lion as a pet? You know, come on, Fido. You need to be able to enjoy it the way God had intended it to do. You know, in verse 2, he says, all things come alike to all. The rain falls upon the just and the unjust. Isn't that true? You know, all of us have to pay taxes at the end of the year, no matter how just or unjust you are. There's one event to the righteous and to the wicked. And to the good and to the wicked, to the good and the clean and to the unclean, to him that is that sacrifices and to him that sacrificed, no. As is the good, so to the sinner. And he that sweareth as he that feareth an oath. It seems like it doesn't really matter if you live good life or you're wicked in Solomon's eyes here. In Saul's eyes, as he's seeing these things, as Solomon is writing these things, he says it doesn't really matter at all. But it does matter, doesn't it? Because as you live for Christ, as you seek to do good, like I desire to be like Christ, and that's what Christian's all about. I want to do things that are right and pleasing. You know, righteousness, to do that. To be right with my neighbor and my coworkers and the people I do with the family of God. I seek to do things that are right and pleasing before the Lord. Jesus said, to set the example for our lives, he said, I always do what? I always do the things that please the Father. That should be the example that we follow day in and day out. Is this something that pleases the Father? Check, yes. If it isn't, then let it go. Seek the things that please the Father. Verse 3. This is an evil among all things that are done under the sun, that there is one event unto all. Yea, also the heart of the sons of men is full of evil, and madness is in their heart while they live, and after that they go to the dead. No matter who you are or how you live, it's and how easy you live in your life. You can't escape. It's really what he's saying. However, we're not all going to experience death like he said. And that's, again, as I talked about earlier, so important. You know, let me tell you something tonight. You'll never die. You might die physically, but you'll pass from this life unto that glorious eternal life that we have. And I can't wait for that day that we go before the Lord. Paul, apostle, tells us, he says, but we know that within this earthly tent, this body which is presently alive, in 1 Corinthians he tells us, goes back to the dust. We have a building of God, a new building, a new house to live in that's not made with hands, eternal in the heaven. So then we which still are living in these bodies do groan earnestly in desire to be freed from the limitation of this body. And he says, not that I would want to be embodied spirit, unbodied spirit, just floating around with no purpose, Paul says. He says, but I want to have, for know you not that I'm still living in this body. I'm absent from the Lord. I would choose rather to be absent from this body than be presence with the Lord. So he's talking about this change. And he says, flesh and blood, he tells us, cannot inherit the kingdom of heaven, Paul says. He says, you can't. This body we're not able to take along with of it. And so Solomon here, not looking at that, not realizing there's a glorious hope to us as believers. In verse 4, for to him that is joined to the living, there is hope. In other words, as long as you live, you have alive, you have hope. But when you're dead, it's all over. That's what he thought. I sometimes, you know, we finish up early on Sunday mornings. We're first service, and then Pastor Odin comes in after us, the second service here. And so we drive home, you know, and every Sunday morning, right, we drive by Miles Square Park. We're over by Miles Square Park, where Misa and I live, and I'm always amazed. Everybody's out running around. They're all jogging, doing their thing. I go, don't they take time to think about their eternity? These people need to be in church, learning about Jesus, learning about God. But yet they'll spend so much time and energy taking care of this body. But what about their spiritual lives? Where are they at? He goes on, he tells us in verse 4, you know, he says, for a living dog is better than a dead lion. I got to kind of like his pictures. You know, dead lion, what could he do? Can't growl at you. Probably be a nice little thing to lay on your ground, a nice rug for you. And he said, but a living dog, he could still bark, right? For the living know that they shall die, but the dead knoweth anything. Dead knoweth no anything, neither have they any more reward, for the memory of them is forgotten. He says, for the living know not they that they should die, for the most part is true. You know, and for the dead know not anything. Job expressed that same feeling, talking about the misery. He says, oh, that I were dead. That's what Job said. Remember, as we were studying the book of Job, oh, that I were dead. Obviously, he was just kind of really void. He had a tough time in his life. Things were going pretty terrible for him upon this earth. It's interesting when God came on the scene towards the end of Job. It's a really good read to go back if you haven't read it for a while. When God starts speaking to Job, he says, you have a bunch of words, but without knowledge. He really did rebuke Job for this. God said, darken is the counsel of the words without knowledge. Then God said, have you been beyond the gates of death? Do you really know what's out there? He says, do you really know? He rebuked him for talking about what he didn't know. You know, we do know. We know what God has for us, and it's a glorious future. One of the things that you might want to read and cross-reference is we get this picture of what life was going on for the Old Testament saints there in the Gospel of Luke, as he talks about a certain rich man that he thought he was doing really well. You all know that story? And he died. And as he died, he had this other guy You know, and while he said he died, he went into Abraham's bosom. And this poor guy, he died also. But he talked about there was a gulf between the two of them. You know, where here this poor beggar was in Abraham's bosom, and this rich man was really being tortured at this time. He continues to be tortured. He wanted to see and try to negotiate with God that this poor guy would go back and really minister to his family members when he got the reality of what life apart from Christ was all about. And Jesus said about the consciousness as far as the dead are concerned, you see, the real body isn't you. You know, one day we'll all be changed. One day we will have to face God, and what we did with Jesus Christ will make the difference. You know, and as I said this morning, and it's worthwhile repeating again tonight, when one man came up to Jesus one time, he says, "What must I do to do the works of God?" What would you guys think? Go to church, pay your tithes, witness to people. All good things. But the Jesus' response to him was very interesting. He said, "Believe on the Son on whom God has sent," because our faith in Jesus Christ gives us the ticket into heaven, gives us the ticket into eternity. That's why Jesus said to Nicodemus, what did he say? You must be what? You must be born again, because your religious works will never get you there. He says, but the dead, they don't know anything in verse 5. Neither have they any more reward. Not so with us. Paul said, "I fought the good fight. I finished the course. I have kept the faith." Notice, I have kept the faith of Jesus. "Henceforth there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness." If we could learn something here tonight, I think the exhortation that we get through the scriptures is keep going. Hang on to Jesus Christ, your faith in God. He says, "But there's laid up for you a crown of righteousness." And you know what? Nobody can take that away from you, because God has given you that crown because you put your faith in Jesus Christ. He says, "For the memory of them is forgotten, those who have died." And that's probably true. You know, I can remember, of course, my dad's dad, which would be my grandfather's name. But what was my great-great-grandfather's name? I had to scratch my head and think. I'd have to go back and look at a family tree. You know, it doesn't take very long before we start forgetting, right? You know, go down the way, and that's what he's saying, Solomon's saying. He says, "Also, their love and their hatred and their envy is now perish." That's true. Death corpses can't love anymore. They can't hate. They have no envy. "Neither have they any more a portion in everything there is done underneath the sun." They can't come back and try to relive it. But when we come back, when our life is over, we're going to be on this earth for a while, won't we? What is the Bible? How long are you going to be here? 1,000 years, reign of Christ. And Jesus promised those that overcome that they'll reign with him on this earth. What a contrast to the sadness here that we have reading here tonight. And then verse 7, it says, "Go thy way, eat thy bread with joy, and drink thy wine with a merry heart, for God now accepts thy work." The conclusion of the just, to make the best of your life, because when your life is over, that's it. Jesus, though, on the flip side, he says, if you seek to save your life, you'll lose it. But if you lose your life for my sake, you'll really find it. I'm sure glad Jesus came around, don't you? To really straighten up from this cranky old man as he wrote these things. And, you know, and he was taking it from a very worldly perspective. Look at that life, how empty it was, because nothing ever satisfied him. He had the largest kingdom that was known to Israel. His land mass was huge. His wealth was beyond what we can imagine. And he had wisdom of all the plant lives and everything that you could do. as I touched on earlier, he could party with everybody and had all the women and concubines and all that. And now you see the emptiness that he has. It's a clear choice. What are we going to do this today? If we live for God, no matter what life might throw us, the curveballs, we'll have his rest and his presence within our lives. If we live for ourselves, we will suffer like that we see here in the scriptures. And we'll pick this up next week where we're at. We're about out of time for this evening. And we'll continue along, and if we get really good speed, we'll probably finish Ecclesiastes next week. And won't be long, a few more weeks. We start in the prophets, studying once again. And God bless you guys. You're willing to give up your Sunday night to come on up, come here and study God's word. Because you all want to grow still, don't you? I do. I keep thinking about that. I hit middle age a while back, and I feel still like I'm middle age. And all of a sudden I go, well, maybe I'm getting a little older. Because my heart is. I want to grow in grace and a knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. That's what, you know whose final words those were? They were Peter's. And he wanted to grow in that knowledge of Jesus. And I believe as we seek each and every day to know him, you think God would say no to you? No, he'll reveal himself through our lives. And he'll help you even this night. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, I just thank you for our time together. Thank you that we got to talk about Jesus tonight. Thank you that as we see the comparison, a man that had so much potential but walked away. And that really the bitterness of his life ate him up. And Lord, I just pray that if we know family members or friends that are just wasting their life, Lord, this night, Lord, as they come to our memories and our thoughts even right now, Lord, that, Lord, you might bring them to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. We would love to hear praise reports of people we know come to know Jesus as their Lord and Savior, so we commit them into your hands. We thank you for the hope that you've given us. Lord, we admit that we still have flaws. We still make mistakes. But we thank you for the shed blood of Jesus, that we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous, that's ever making intercession for us. Tonight, if you came in discouraged, maybe guilt-ridden or just down, as John says, if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. John wrote that to Christians. Help us, Lord, to walk in that forgiveness even this day, this night, in Jesus' name. Amen. Why don't we all stand?